squat, drop that fat butt, hold those nuts. The guard said that to Project Daddy 4 times in 4 minutes from 4 different cells. And he was getting a good laugh out of it. And when I said that I didn't want to do it again, guess what? They said, you ain't going to eat. And I stood there butt neck and they said, I wasn't getting no food. How can you treat a human person like that? Project Daddy had never been so degraded and humiliated in his entire life.
The greatest American alive.
Prison is one of the craziest systems in the whole entire universe because you think that they're punishing someone. No, they're not punishing the person. They're not. They're punishing you as society. They're using tax dollars to incarcerate American men.
Imprisonment is the third largest employer in the United States. The first one, I think, is Walmart. Ironically, at a moment of mass deindustrialization that's hitting people of color in the cities, but also white workers, imprisonment in the United States became a vehicle for employing very poor community white communities in rural areas and in small white towns.
Do you know someone who's incarcerated? Do you have a family member or a friend who's incarcerated? I mean, on the local level or in the prison system, do you know someone who is locked down right now? If you do know someone who is incarcerated, what is your level of support? Do you write letters? Do you send them a JPay? Do you send them some money sometimes? Incarceration in America is one of the nastiest things the world has ever seen, and we have to ask wonderful questions. We don't ever look at the numbers. If you look at how many people are incarcerated in America,
part of what we're seeing is the willingness of the state to sacrifice the lives of thousands and thousands of people to essentially condemn them to the death penalty, because that is essentially what is happening in the prisons right now. I think it's important to note that of the 2.4 million people incarcerated, half of them were unemployed at the time that they were arrested.
Real American citizens, our friends, our brothers, our sisters, our cousins, our loved ones, our fathers and mothers, our loved ones are incarcerated, and we act like these people are bad people. We always blame the person, but we never blame the system. I'm curious, whomever is in prison, whoever you know that's incarcerated, tell me what school they went to. Tell me what elementary school, middle school, high school. Tell me those schools they went to. Can you not blame the system in which created these people? If you look at a person who's doing well, and they went to wonderful high schools, they went to a good middle school, and they went off to, I don't know, some Ivy League school like Harvard or something. You say, oh man, he went to all the finest institutions. That's why he's so smart. That's why he has so many wonderful opportunities, yes? Now, if we ask the exact same question about other wonderful human beings, other wonderful Americans who went to really terrible schools, who went to a terrible middle school and a terrible high school, and then did not have the opportunity to go on to a higher learning, do we blame the institution which created this person? The American school system is a multi-billion dollar operation. And then if we have wonderful American citizens who fail out, flunk out of this American institution, which costs us billions of dollars, then we'll spend more billions of dollars to send them into penitentiary.
In the 70s and 80s, a massive intensification of deindustrialization. That is that jobs are leaving the cities to the suburbs and to the south and then abroad in stages. And there is permanent unemployment in the cities. The hyper-incarceration of Black and brown bodies is a way to deal with this crisis of unemployment, which is greater than it had ever been before.
How in the world do we continue to fail the American citizen? How in the world do we continue to fail your family members, your loved ones? Why in the world do we continue to fail the greatest American alive? If you watch any of Project Daddy's videos, I'm always throwing out big numbers because America has one of the biggest economies on the planet. It's not the biggest. China's is. When we have this gigantic economy, at the height of the pandemic, the United States government spent $85 billion to feed American families. That was over 140 million people living in poverty, needed some food because they couldn't go to work. And then if you look at the prison system, the United States government spends $80 billion a year to incarcerate less than 2 million people. How in the world can we make that add up? The only way we can rationalize an irrational system is if we think these wonderful American people, your friends, your family, your loved ones, could be you, the greatest American alive. The only way we can rationalize an irrational system is if we say these people deserve to be incarcerated. If we say these wonderful human beings deserve to be incarcerated, and then we back it by saying that in order to incarcerate these people, we have to spend $31,500 a year for these people to be in prison. How is that justified when a person who's incarcerated, we spend spend more money on them being in jail than we do on you.
The greatest American alive.
If you work at Walmart, Walgreens, Target, you do not make over $30,000 a year and you're working full time. What does that say to you when you go to work every day and we value American prisoners more than we value the American worker? What does that say to you, the greatest American alive, when you know that we value the American prisoner more than we value the American worker? Why aren't you worth as much as a prisoner who's incarcerated? And now if you start looking at these numbers, why would we spend $80 billion to incarcerate American people? The majority of these are men.
The mass expansion of prisons is happening alongside a problem of the state that it can no longer employ large numbers of people living in the city. And so the state essentially comes down hard on these communities that it's not able to absorb. And these communities become dispensable in American society.
The United States government has a standing army incarcerated, and they're spending $80 billion to keep these wonderful human men. Man, what could you do with the labor force of 1 million men? What could you build with 1 million American men? What type of things could we accomplish? Instead of investing in these wonderful American people, we invest in them being incarcerated, and we'll say that an American prisoner is worth more than an American worker. If you think that makes sense, then you can continue to support the prison industrial complex. How am I supposed to address a system in which they'll incarcerate me? But then when I read that Barack Obama says, when our laws, our leaders, or our government are out of alignment with our ideals, then the dissent of ordinary Americans may prove to be one of the truest expressions of patriotism. The president said that. And so if that's coming from the highest office in America that tells you that you have to take a stand for yourself, and if your representatives are not representing you appropriately, if they're locking up your family, your cousins, your friends, and you know that they created the system in which these people fell out of, can we have honest conversations? If you live in an urban area, if you live in a city and you don't have any manufacturing and all you have is Walmart and Amazon, and then you have some fast food places, and you have a large percentage of your working men who are underemployed or unemployed.
That of the 2.4 million people incarcerated, half of them were unemployed at the time that they were arrested. Half of the 2.4 million people who are incarcerated today were unemployed at the time of their incarceration. And the rest had an annual income of approximately $10,000. So what happens when the state is incapable of meeting the basic needs of so many of its citizens? It hammers them.
What is the impact that it has on your city? City planners, governments, they know all these things. They know all the numbers. And so when they have excess manpower, they make a decision to say, hey, man, instead of investing in infrastructure, we're going to invest in putting these people in prison. Prison is one of the nastiest systems in the history of the world. The American incarceration system is one of the nastiest systems in the history of the world. It has one purpose and one purpose only: to handicap working class people. The American prison system has one purpose and one purpose only, is to cripple the working class and the poor to make sure that they do not have the resources to stand up against an oppressive system. That's the whole point of the prison industrial complex. They have an excess of human talent. They have too much human power. And so to make sure the system remains powerful, they will incarcerate these people and say, they did a bad thing. Got to punish them. But what are the limits to that punishment? Project Daddy was in prison. One day they stripped me down 4 times in 4 minutes. From one cell to the next cell to the next cell, they told Project Daddy, squat, drop that fat butt, hold those nuts. The guard said that to Project Daddy 4 times in 4 minutes from 4 different cells. And he was giving a good laugh out of it. And when I said that I didn't want to do it again, guess what? They said, you ain't going to eat. And I stood there butt neck, and they said I wasn't getting no food. How can you treat a human person like that? Project Daddy had never been so degraded and humiliated in his entire life. Have you ever stood shoulder to shoulder with 50 men and then get told to strip down butt naked and then do that exact same process? Squat, drop your big butt, hold your nuts right next to another person. He's holding his nuts right next to you. 50 men shoulder to shoulder, all squatting, dropping their butt, holding their nuts. Project Daddy had never been so demoralized ever. And for some reason, we'll call that punishment. And when we have these wonderful men, yes, people in prison, there are wonderful men in prison. I'm not going to say every man in prison is a wonderful person, but I will say that the system failed them. I will say that their elementary school failed them. I will say that their government failed them. I will say that America failed the greatest American alive. That's the truth.
The greatest American alive.
There is no political party in America that represents the economically challenged or the politically disenfranchised. That party does not exist. And the next step of social justice is political liberation. You have to migrate away from a two-party system because those people do not represent you, the greatest American alive. They do not represent anyone that makes less than $35,000 a year. Guess who falls in the category of making less than $35,000 a year? Prisoners. You pay $31,500 a year for every incarcerated person in America. That's on average. And so if you work at one of these places in America that makes less than $30,000 a year, you make that make sense. Rationalize it. And if you say, well, those are just bad people, are you a good person? I'm curious. And if you are a good person, don't you deserve more than a bad person? Project that is sitting in prison playing spades, watching ESPN, some good old cable on the American dollar while you clocking in every day going to Amazon trying to figure out how you're going to find a place to stay. If we don't have honest conversations, we can't get no power. If we don't have the courage or the imagination to have a better conversation, the American people are going to be lost. You, the greatest American alive, are going to be lost. We have to listen to those who tell us the truth, yes? Sometimes people in power will say something that is profound. They will make a statement that has a kernel of truth. The 44th president of the United States of America said, when our laws, our leaders, or our government are out of alignment with our ideals, then the descent of ordinary Americans may prove to be one of the truest expressions of patriotism. Barack Obama, what are our ideals? What do you, the greatest American alive, what do you believe in? And do you believe that you should be turned into a commodity? The American person is being bought and sold on the open market and there is no dissent. Instead, we will further turn ourselves into a commodity by selling ourselves on social media. By selling ourselves on social media, the monetization of the human person is making us all commodities. I will sell my soul to make a dollar. I will sell my body to make a dollar. I will forfeit any moral value that I have to make a dollar. I was incarcerated and now I'm free. Project Daddy was once incarcerated and now I'm free. And being incarcerated told me one thing, that I'm worth at least $31,500 every year. And if you say that you can't get that on the open market, then I'm going to ask, okay, how in the hell do you have a prison system that you invest that much money in me, but I come back to the open market and I can't command an exact same value? We hustling backwards, and Project Daddy is not going to hustle backwards. I am not going to take less when you tell me what my human value is. Project Daddy does not have the capacity to rationalize an irrational system. Tell the truth and get some power. Fight for freedom. Tell the truth and get some power. Fight for freedom. There are superheroes that have existed that challenge the economic power structure in America. Floyd Mckissick was one of these people. And if we do not support wonderful superheroes, then we will allow ourselves to continue to be a commodity, and the American government will take advantage of us. Our society produces superheroes. Fred Hampton was a superhero, and they gunned that young man down because that young man stood against the economic power system of America.
I believe that white workers have been struggling. They're some of the most violent people in the world. I believe that what they need is they need a redirection in their ideology and in their politics. They need to know who to struggle against. The workers need to start to begin to learn that their job is to struggle against the bosses. And until they do this, then struggle is incorrect. It's like no struggle at all. We say that if you don't struggle correctly, you shouldn't struggle. But you should struggle. We said dare to struggle and you dare to win. Dare not to struggle and you don't deserve the win. But we have to struggle properly.
The greatest American alive.
But when you decide to disengage from trying to tell a person what to do with their body and having conversations about social justice and start having conversations about economic power, then the system gets scared. The economic system gets scared. The United States of America was built on capitalism. The United States of America was not designed on the idea of you being your true self. The idea of America was designed for you to have economic gain. And if we're not talking about economic power in America, then we're having the wrong conversation. There is no political party in America that represents the economically challenged or the politically disenfranchised. That party does not exist. If we do not fight for economic power and political power, then we're going to be lost. It is your job to tell any power structure that you cannot take advantage of me. You cannot exploit me. You cannot turn me into a commodity. I will not allow it. I am the greatest citizen the world has ever seen because I am the greatest American alive and I built the greatest economy the world has ever seen. This is power. Get some power by telling the truth. If you know someone who is incarcerated, you better love that wonderful human person. You better fight for that wonderful human person, because if you're not writing that person letters, if you're not sending that person any money, if you're not showing any type of moral or economic support to your loved ones who are incarcerated, they're sitting there going crazy. Their minds are running wild and they're asking, why doesn't my family love me? Why doesn't this American government love me? Why does the system hate me so much? Why do we hate poor people so much? Why do we hate ourselves so much? We participate in billion-dollar institutions from the time that we're born. We're born in a hospital, billion-dollar institution. Elementary school, billion-dollar institution. Middle school, high school, college, so on and so forth. And then we go to prison and we participate in all of these billion-dollar institutions. And at no point in time do we ever feel that we believe to get our actual worth, instead of you profiting off of me, maybe I should profit off of myself. And this goes for every powerful institution in the world. You are the greatest American alive. The greatest American alive.
The greatest American alive. The greatest American alive. The greatest American alive. The greatest American alive. The greatest American alive.